Hydra the Sea Serpent is the largest of the 88 modern constellations, and it stretches across more than 100 degrees of celestial longitude. Despite its vast size, Hydra is often difficult to trace because its stars are faint. This massive constellation winds its way beneath Cancer, Leo, and Virgo, and it stretches from the southern part of the sky to the eastern part of the sky in the northern hemisphere. It's best seen in the springtime and can be seen well into the summer as well. Hydra is the largest of all 88 constellations officially recognized by the International Astronomical Union. It's an ancient constellation and is first mentioned in the Babylonian star catalogs, though it's commonly associated with Greek mythology. Hydra was also included in Ptolemy's list of 48 constellations written in the 2nd century CE. The name Hydra comes from Latin, meaning female water snake, and today it's classified as a seasonal constellation, starting to be seen in the spring months and well into summer in the northern hemisphere. When can you see Hydra? It's best seen from April to August, and it can be seen in both the northern and southern hemispheres. The best way to find it is to look for Cancer. The head of Hydra is right underneath Cancer. However, you can also use Corvus to help you find the tail of Hydra, and I'll go into detail about this in the next part of the video. Keep in mind, it's a faint constellation. It's really large, so it can be difficult to see it in its entirety, and the stars are a fairly even magnitude. Let's take a look at the pattern that Hydra makes across the sky. As you look at this celestial map, bring your eyes to where Cancer is in the upper right portion of the screen. So from there, right underneath Cancer is where you can find the head of Hydra. It kind of looks like a little circle in the star pattern. And then as you follow the long sinuous body, you'll come to the alpha star, which is Alphard. And this is the brightest star in Hydra. And then as you continue across the sky, you should reach all the way to the left lower portion of the screen. And that's where the tail of Hydra is. And you should notice that Hydra, it spans across how many zodiacal constellations? Cancer, Leo, Virgo, and Libra. So 4 zodiacal constellations. It's a huge portion of the sky. As we said earlier, it's the largest of the 88 constellations. And here are some of the celestial objects that are located in the boundaries of this constellation, which we'll talk about a little bit later in this video. So we'll go through a series of pictures to help you get practice on being able to identify Hydra. The first one we're going to start with is this one. And while it's a fairly grainy photo, it's the only one I have that shows Hydra in its entirety. So you just have to work with the bright stars, and I'll point everything else out to you as we go. And as you're looking at this photo, you should notice the very bright star, which is not really a star, but a planet. And this is Jupiter. And the other constellation that's kind of in the, not quite in the center, but upper center, is Leo the Lion. And you can use Leo the Lion to help you find kind of the middle of Hydra and the brightest star in Hydra. So from there, let's point out some other things. Okay. Right next to Jupiter is the bright star Spica, and then above it is Arcturus. And remember, you can find these two stars by using the Big Dipper. You use the handle of the Big Dipper to arc to Arcturus and speed to Spica. And from there, we can point out some of the other constellations we're going to see. Here's where Cancer is. It's very grainy and hard to see. Gemini is there, and Canis Minor. The other key to finding Hydra is using Cancer. So here we have Cancer circled, and this is where Hydra is. And you can see it's the reason it's so difficult to get a full picture of Hydra is because it's difficult to take a picture of, you know, most of the sky. So I can't say for myself that I've seen Hydra in its entirety, very close to it, but not the whole thing. So, and if we were to point out everything else here, you can use the question mark shape or the sickle shape in Leo to aim you towards Alphard, which is the brightest star in Hydra. And then you can use Cancer always to use to find the head of Hydra. That's the easiest part of Hydra, I think, to find. And then if you arc to Arcturus and speed to Spica, you can use that bright blue star of Spica and Corvus, this kind of four-sided shape right there, to help you find the tail of Hydra. And there's other constellations in here that I didn't point out. And while it's a grainy photo, it's still a really useful one to see where everything else lies in the sky. Another thing you can do is use the torso or the paws of Leo to help you find the head of Hydra as well. So in summary, be sure to use both Leo the Lion and the Beehive Star Cluster in order to find the head of Hydra. In this next photo, the goal is for you to find the head of Hydra, and we're going to do that using Cancer, but first we're going to look at Gemini, and Gemini is in the center of this photograph, and there's some other constellations we have here as well. Hopefully, if you've been watching my channel for a while, I've got videos on all this stuff here. I'll leave them in the links below, but what we have here is Cancer that is right at the upper center part of the photo, maybe a little bit towards the left. And when you're looking at Cancer, you want to look for the Beehive Cluster. And here in this photo, it's really easy to see. Now kind of use that as an arrow to help you find the head of Hydra. However, I usually only see this portion, the rest of it, you know, often dips below the horizon for me to see. And how much of Hydra you will see is dependent upon your latitude on Earth. And another way to find Hydra is using the constellation of Corvus. And when you're looking at this photo, I want you to notice the brightest star, that's Spica. And then this four-sided shape, this quadrilateral, is known as Corvus. And from there, use it as a pointer to help you, to help direct you towards the tail of Hydra. But whether or not you can see the entirety of Hydra really depends on a lot of things. How much of the sky are you able to see? Is there any part of the horizon that's hidden? And are you in an area that has dark skies? If you're living in a city with lots of light pollution, there's really a low likelihood of you being able to find this constellation. You really have to escape city lights. In order to get more practice with how to find Hydra in the night sky, I'm going to use a planetarium software, or at least an online version of it called Stellarium. I think this is a great way to show you how Hydra is connected to other constellations. So as we look at Hydra, it's easy to find using this because it's very long and sinuous and it stands out, but that's not realistic. If you were to turn these off and just look at the stars, I don't think Hydra stands out very much, but I know it's right in the middle of my screen and it's long and sinuous, but the patterns that do stand out are Leo here. Okay, here's Corvus down by the tail of Hydra. And then here, I know Cancer is right around here because I always look for the sickle asterism and I know Cancer is nearby. So if I were to turn the constellations back on, you can see here's where Cancer is. And then here's where Hydra is, and it comes in contact with multiple constellations. And the pattern here that you're seeing is slightly different than the one I showed you in the map, but constellation patterns vary depending upon its source. And much as I say there's no one mythology that is true for any constellation, I feel like I could say that for the pattern as well. So you really want to use Cancer in early springtime in the Northern Hemisphere around March and April, and that's where the head of Hydra will start to appear. And then that'll last all throughout the spring, even into the summer as well. So I hope this was helpful for you to understand that Hydra is very difficult to find. There are parts of it that are easier to find than others, but if you want to really see Hydra, you have to escape the city lights. Try to get like 50 to 70 miles away from the city for the stars to really come out. And you have to get practice being able to find the other constellations that surround it, such as Leo and Cancer and Virgo. And I have videos on all these other constellations, so you can use those to tutor yourself and practice on how to find these constellations to help you find Hydra. Now let's review the brightest star in this constellation. The brightest star in Hydra is called Alphard, and this means the solitary one in Arabic. It is a K-type orange giant star located 177 light years away, and it glows with an apparent magnitude of 2.0. It earns its name for being noticeably alone. It's surrounded by relatively dim neighbors, and the best way to find Alphard is to use Leo the Lion. Trace the sickle shape of the lion's head to find Regulus, and extend towards the next brightest star, and here's where you will find Alphard. Hydra is home to some remarkable deep sky objects, so if you own a telescope, this is a great constellation to find a variety of things. Here's a map of Hydra and the main objects you can see. And keep in mind that when you look at this star map, there are specific symbols that correlate with the type of object it is. As we go over these objects, we'll start with the smallest ones all the way up to the largest ones. And we'll start with an object called NGC 3242. It's classified as a planetary nebula, and its distance is roughly 1,400 light years away. And when you look at it through a telescope, it glows eerily, kind of like a tiny bluish-green disk. It does have an apparent magnitude of 8.6, so you would need a telescope to see it. Another planetary nebula that you can see that's located right along the boundary of Hydra and Sextans is called the Diamond Ring Nebula. This planetary nebula is located 2,700 light years away. And this is a star that is at the end of its life cycle. It's starting to shed its outer layers, and the remaining gas just drifts off into space, and it leaves behind a glowing shell of ionized gas. And this shell of gas is sculpted by stellar winds that are flowing away from the star. Hydra also has some notable star clusters within its borders. The first is called Messier 48, and it is near the head of Hydra. Messier 48 is an open star cluster located around 2,500 light years away. It has an apparent magnitude of 5.5, so this makes it visible to the naked eye if you are located within dark sky areas. This object is best seen with a pair of binoculars. The next star cluster is called Messier 68, and it's a globular star cluster located approximately 33,000 light years away. It has a magnitude of 8, so a pair of binoculars or a telescope are needed to see this object. Keep in mind that there are two different types of star clusters: an open star cluster, which is a loose grouping of stars without a particular shape, and then there's globular clusters. These are dense spherical collections of hundreds of thousands of ancient stars, and they orbit the galaxy center. So they always appear farther away than open star clusters because they reside in the galactic halo, whereas open star clusters are typically found within the main disk of a galaxy. I do have a whole video comparing the two different types of star clusters, so be sure to click on the link below to learn more. Now we will explore the largest object in this constellation. It's called Messier 83, also known as the Southern Pinwheel Galaxy, and it's a barred spiral galaxy located approximately 15 million light years away, and it's renowned for its brilliance in long exposure astrophotography. It ranks among one of the brightest spiral galaxies visible in the night sky, and it earns its nickname due to the striking resemblance it has to the more northern Pinwheel Galaxy, which is also called Messier 101. Let's examine some of the legends behind Hydra. It's often the stories behind the stars that help us form a connection and make the constellations easier to remember. And keep in mind, with countless cultures looking at the sky, there are as many star legends as there are stars. So the first record of Hydra comes from the Babylonian star charts. Long before modern star charts, the Babylonians mapped the heavens with remarkable precision. These clay tablets are a record of 71 stars and constellations, and each celestial object was given a specific prefix name, meaning star, followed by the name of a deity, which reflected the divine nature of the night sky according to their vision. The name for Hydra, before it was called Hydra, was the Serpent Star of the Gods, according to the Babylonians. This catalog also included paired constellations, those that rose together and set together, or appeared at the zenith and horizon at the same time. This ancient knowledge laid the foundation for celestial navigation that would come in later civilizations. Hydra the water snake is also well known from its many appearances in Greek mythology. Hydra was said to have guarded the entrance to the underworld, or in some tales, protect the golden fleece. In another legend, Hydra defends the sacred cup of Apollo, which is represented as the constellation Crater, and it was protecting it from Corvus, the thirsty crow. In this legend, Apollo sends the crow to fetch water using a sacred bowl, but along the way, the crow becomes distracted and stops to feast on ripe figs. This side quest delayed the crow, and he eventually flies back to Apollo with an excuse. He blamed the water snake for blocking the spring, but Apollo saw through the lie, and as a punishment, he casts all three into the sky: the crow, which is Corvus, the bowl, which is called Crater, and the serpent, which is Hydra. And there, the serpent forever guards the bowl, ensuring that the crow can never reach the water and remains thirsty. Another well-known Greek myth featuring Hydra comes from the story of Heracles' 12 labors. In the second labor, Heracles faced a multi-headed, serpent-like creature with 9 venomous heads, one of which was immortal. Each time a head was severed, 2 more would grow in its place, making the battle nearly impossible, until Heracles, with the help of his nephew Aeolus, used fire to cauterize the necks and prevent regrowth. After finally defeating Hydra, Heracles buried its immortal head beneath a massive rock and dipped his arrows in its poisonous blood. This powerful myth of Hydra may reflect an even older story from Babylonian mythology, where the hero Gilgamesh battles and defeats a many-headed monster, hinting at a deeper cross-cultural origin of the many-headed serpent legend. Remember, the legends of the stars vary according to time, place, and culture. There is no one true mythology for any constellation, just a variety of them. We've come to the end of our video about Hydra, the sea serpent, also known as the water snake. So let's review everything we've learned. Hydra is the largest of the 88 modern constellations, and it's best seen from March through August. It's considered a seasonal constellation because it isn't visible all year round. Hydra can be challenging to spot, but there are helpful strategies to find its parts. To locate the head of Hydra, start by finding Cancer. You can use Leo also to help guide you there. For the midsection, you want to use the sickle of Leo to lead you towards Alphard, the brightest star in Hydra. To find the tail, look for Corvus, which lies near Spica. And remember the classic skyhopping tip. You arc to Arcturus from the Big Dipper and then speed to Spica, and you'll be right in the area to find Corvus and Hydra's tail. Within Hydra's boundaries, there are many fascinating celestial objects to discover. Let me know in the comments, have you ever tried identifying this constellation? And for the astrophotographers out there, have you captured any amazing images of Hydra or its deep sky treasures? This video, for me, has been a long time in the making. I actually checked my revision history and saw that I started working on this back in 2021. And here we are in 2025, and I'm finally finishing it. One of the biggest challenges was finding the right images to help navigate you through the sky, but it all came together for me when I finally saw Hydra with my own eyes the night before the solar eclipse in 2024. I was out stargazing the night before and managed to trace Hydra from its head all the way to its tail. Although some parts were hidden by trees, it really was a thrilling moment for me. I felt confident that I could see it, I could identify it, and now I knew I could help others find it too. So tell me, have you seen Hydra? What was your experience like? What kind of adventure were you on at the time? Thank you so much for watching. I truly appreciate your support. If you'd like to support this channel further, check out my new book, Starry Wonders, Exploring the 25 Brightest Stars in the Night Sky. In it, you'll find some stargazing strategies, a look into the life of stars, and detailed explorations of the brightest star systems we can see. And remember, learning how to find constellations takes time, patience, and practice. I encourage you to step outside, take a friend or a furry companion with you, and look up. Because when you change your perspective, there's no telling where it might lead you.